Your confidence, please listen to me. Your confidence will have a lot to do with your courage, your ability to conquer fear. Many of us here in ministry, if you don't conquer fear, you will never be able to rise in ministry. Many of us here are trusting God for financial liftings. If you put your eyes around the economy of nations, they looked unto him and their faces were lightened. It's in your Bible. Gentiles will come to my light. They are kings to the brightness of my rising. It says that my gates will be continually open day and night. They will not be shut, that I will receive the forces of the Gentiles. When he said this, I believed him. I don't know what you don't believe about God, but tonight you are going to call fear by its name and curse it by the God of heaven. I reject fear. Lift your voice and pray. The fear of death, the fear of accident. Pray, ladies. Will I get a man that will marry me? Will I get a woman that will marry me? I curse fear. Will I have responsible children? Will I ever have a house of my own? Shibaranda kasabradisha labakus embradisa ziana katapras kede baladash. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Matthew chapter 6 from verse 24. Jesus was dealing with something we continue to ignore. Next verse. Therefore, I say unto you, take no thought. The word there is don't fear, don't worry. It doesn't mean don't be responsible. Mm-mm. Take no thought of your life. Worry. What you shall eat. Nigerians, listen. What you shall drink. Nor yet for your body what you shall put on. Is not the life more than meat, and the body more than raiment? Next verse. The fowls of the air break a fundamental law. Because if you don't sow, you should not reap. But because God doesn't only love you, he has come down to even love the birds. He says they neither sow, meaning they should not reap. Yet your heavenly father, not their own, your heavenly father extends the benevolence even to them. Are ye not much better than they? Next verse. Which of you by taking thought, fear, worry, can add one cubit to his stature? Worry and fear does not do anything positive to you. Doesn't. Next verse, please. And why ye take thought for raiment? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They toil not. They violate the principle of diligence and productivity. Neither do they spin. Next verse. And yet I say unto you, my goodness, that even Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. 30. Wherefore, if God so clothed the grass of the field, this is a revelation of his love now, which today is and tomorrow is cast into the oven, shall he not much more clothe you, O ye of little faith? Next verse. Therefore, take no thought, and don't go to the extent of verbalizing your fear by saying, what shall we eat? What shall we drink? Or wherewithal shall we be clothed? Look at this verse. For after these things do the Gentiles run after. For your heavenly Father knows that ye have need of these things. Your heavenly Father knows that if you stay in a rented apartment forever, it will affect your Christian life. Your heavenly Father knows that if you do not smile and you are not in joy, it will affect your Christian life. He knows. He knows. He knows. He knows that if ministry does not work for you, there will not be a platform. You will be discouraged. He knows. There is no temptation, the Bible says, but such as is common to man. He says, and with every temptation, God will make a way of escape. You are not the first to be challenged by poverty, to be challenged by, there will always be. The jealousy of God will make him manipulate a way and come through for you. Are we together? I'd like you to lift your voice and begin to speak everything you know God has said must happen to you, and say, Lord, I believe you. I believe you. The sorrow that comes with worry. Gentlemen, pray. Stress and worry is destroying young people in our generation. There are people who have lost sleep because of fear. Lost sleep because of worry. It is the keeper of Israel that does not sleep nor slumber, so that I can rest. Great things have I spoken of you, O Zion. Great things. Great things. He called me the head and not the tail, I believe. He called me above and not beneath, I believe. He called me the delight of nations, Beulah and Hephzibah, I believe. With long life will I satisfy you and show you my salvation. I believe. I refuse to fear. I refuse to fear. I reject fear. I refuse to fear. The love of God shields me from fear. The power of God shields me from fear. The mind of Christ shields me from fear. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Listen. Many people, you know, when you hear me talk like this, many people are apostles, it's because you are not looking for food to eat or this and that. Let me tell you this. The Bible says to be carnally minded is death. It's not will bring death. It's already death. But to be spiritually minded is life and peace. When you allow your mind to become carnal, sensual, that's the realm of Satan. How will it come? How will I see the rain? How will I see the cloud? But he said, you may not see rain. Ah, you may not see wind. Yet the valley shall be filled. Who told you water must come from above? Doesn't the earth have water too? When it was time for Noah's flood, water came from the sky, water came from under. Who told you gold is only found under the earth? When a fish brought gold. That means what is not supposed to make sense can bring you gold and bless you and change your life. This is the God we are talking about. I know him more. I know what he can do. I know what he can do. I know what he can do. You are going to hold someone's hand. We'll sing this song once and then we'll wrap up for tonight. Jesus, you love me too much. Oh. Jesus, you love me too much. Excess love. Hallelujah. When you look at Pastor Alpha's wife or Jimmy's wife or any of our gentlemen here, if you see the way, for instance, he decorates his wife, and you are offended, is she the right person to talk to? You go to the husband. The wife is just a wife. So he says, I will walk a walk in your days. I want to do something that even if it were told you yourself, you will not believe. That there are times that a husband can buy a gift for a wife and say, ah, is this not too much? Honey, where did you get the money? Say, I've been saving this to prove something to you. There are certain testimonies, let me tell you, that some of you are going to enter into, that you will even be afraid of sharing, because those who hear it will think you are lying. It's true. This is not motivation. Please listen to me. I'm speaking to you by the Spirit. Ah. When a man's ways pleases the Lord, that he can make even his enemies. Look at this. Abimelech took the wife of Abraham. Abraham lied and he took the wife and wanted to lie with the wife. And God said, if you do this, Abraham, hold on, he's touching me. If you touch this man's wife, listen, there are men who receive answers even before they call. The moment God is on a surveillance of their life, he's jealous, he will be distracted by the worship in heaven and come back again. The love will not allow him leave you. Listen, King Nebuchadnezzar loved Daniel so much that when they now put him in a position where he had to punish Daniel, he could not sleep in the night. By the morning, he went himself, oh Daniel, are you still alive? Has your God been able to deliver you? A king cannot sleep because someone is in trouble. That means there is someone in this country and somewhere. Listen, was it not because of God's love for Esther and Mordecai? The king sat down and he could not sleep. He was rolling from left to right. And he got up, he said, bring me the chronicles. Out of all the people that did nice things, when he came to Mordecai, he said, this man, what has been done? Who is in the chamber? Haman came. He said, what should be done? Hi. This God, bah, my brothers and my sisters, when you believe God and get fear out of your life, you will stand in shock as you see God give you prepared blessings, levels of liftings that God will bring you. You will look left and right, you will not know what you are doing there, and say, Lord, I shouldn't be here. And he says, I brought you there. I brought you there. I brought you there. By my Spirit, I brought you there. Please, I'd like you to lift your voice, even if this is for the last time again. Destroy the spirit of fear and the bondage that it has put upon your life. The bondage it has subjected you to. I will prosper, even in Nigeria. I will prosper in the name of Jesus Christ. Everything that proceeds from me succeeds. Everything that proceeds from me succeeds. No fear, no fear. I reject the bondage of fear. I reject the bondage of fear. My mind is free from fear. My life is free from fear. Financial fear, marital fear, parenting fear, career fear, business fear, ministry fear, promotion fear, advancement fear. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Listen, the next time fear comes to you, don't just say I cast you. Suddenly remember you are a woman who is married. Whether you are a male or female, everybody is a bride in the realm of the spirit. Remember who paid your dowry. Remember the price. You talk about expensive dowry, ask Jesus, ask the Father. Your own dowry, you bought cow and yam. You didn't die for your wife. Something else died. Jesus didn't say I would die for you. He died for you and purchased you. What can separate us? The only thing that can separate you is so anything that can die for you too. Can sickness die for you? Can failure die for you? You will never find me putting my hand on my chin by the window or by the bed, breathing life. No. Why should I fear? Why should I fear? Why should I walk? Why should I fear? Why should I fear? Why should I fear? One more time. Why should I fear? Why should I fear? Why should I fear? Why should I fear? Listen, I'd like you to square your shoulder and walk boldly through life. Boldly through life. Don't walk around like somebody who is at the mercy of situations and circumstances. If you don't have confidence in yourself, have confidence in your marriage. Hallelujah. It shall be like a tree that is planted by the streams of water, which yields its fruit in season, and whose leaf does not wither. Whatsoever he doeth prospers. Father, I declare in the name that is above all names, that anyone here suffering under any kind of the manipulation of the spirit of fear, be free right now in the name of Jesus. Be free right now in the name of Jesus. Whether it is fear because of the class of degree you finished with, fear because of your tribe, fear because of your past, fear because of those you don't have that you think are support, I curse that spirit from your life now. I decree and I declare the bondage and the chain that has come upon your mind and your life as a result of fear, let it be loosed now from your life. Adam, where art thou? I heard thy voice, but I hid because I was naked. Fear. Right in the garden. Fear. I heard your voice to bless me, but I hid because I thought you will destroy me. I decree that the boldness that comes from knowing you are loved by the Father, may that boldness rest upon you now. The revelation of the love of God that must indoctrinate you into believing you cannot fail. may that grace come upon you. In the name of Jesus Christ. And I declare unto you, I don't care how many times you have failed, by this revelation I empower you to excel. May you become the desire of men. May you become the desire of nations. That every time men are looking for someone to bless, may your face come. In the name of Jesus Christ.
Next day they came and God did not accept it. What is, I mean, how can a man sit down and finish talking with God and leave you to come with all your compassion and yet God will not listen to you? That's not where we're going. But you just listen carefully. And Saul said, bring hither a burnt offering to me and peace offerings. And he offered the burnt offerings. The question is, he offered them to who? Was it not to God? Shouldn't God at least be grateful and say, I see your compassion for the people. I see that you are a visionary leader. Instead of allowing this, I will quarrel Samuel for coming late. Samuel, you didn't keep your word, so I justify Saul. But let's see what happened. And it came to pass that as soon as he had made an end of the offering and the burnt offering, behold, Samuel came, and Saul went out to greet him, to salute him. 11. And Samuel said, what hast thou done? Not well done for your initiative. What hast thou done? And Saul said, because I saw that the people were scattered from me, and that thou camest not within the days appointed, and that the Philistines gathered themselves together at Michmash. Therefore, said I, the Philistines will come down upon me to Gilgal, and I have not made supplication unto the Lord. I forced myself, therefore, and offered a burnt offering. 13. And Samuel said to Saul, what did he say you have done? You have done foolishly. This is not an angel talking to a man. This is another man talking to a man. That you have done foolishly. Thou hast not kept what? The commandment of the Lord thy God, which he commanded thee. For now the Lord would have established thy kingdom upon Israel forever. Verse 14. But now, hi, just for violating a simple pattern, was it that bad? Yes, sir. Could it be that the wilderness journey of many families, the wilderness journey of many believers, and maybe quite honestly, even including us men and women of God, could it be that it is not just because God is not keeping his word, but that spiritual patterns have been violated? Are we together now? But now, the Lord, their kingdom shall not continue. The Lord had sought him a man after his own heart. So you become a man after God's heart, not just by singing, by your diligence to keep the patterns. The ability to preserve his patterns is proof that you love him. Not just proof that you want something from him. Number 3. 2 Samuel chapter 6. Very popular story. Please follow me. We'll read the first 12 verses. You know the scripture. That the ark of God was ready to return to the city of David. We're reading the first 12 verses. And again David gathered together all the chosen men of Israel, 30,000. And David arose and went with all the people that were with him from Baal of Judah to bring from hence the ark of God. Now listen. Whose name was called by the name of the Lord of hosts that dwelleth between the cherubims. And they set the ark of God on a new cart. Something is beginning to go wrong. Because according to the law of priesthood, that the ark of God was designed to be carried upon the shoulder of men, Now these guys were excited and said, no, let's invent another technology to make the work easy. Good intentions will not cover for violation of spiritual patterns. They dropped everything upon a new cart, the Bible says, and brought it out of the house of Abinadab that was in Gibeah. And Uzzah and Ahio, the sons of Abinadab, drove the new cart. So Uzzah was one of the drivers. 5. And David and all the house of Israel played before the Lord on all manner of instruments made of this and that and that. Verse 6. And when they came to Nacon's threshing floor, listen carefully. The Bible says something happened. You've seen people with trailer carrying all of these containers. And sometimes the container can shift. You know it's risky, isn't it? And so they can park to adjust it. That was what happened there. The ark shifted. It was out of balance. So Uzzah, as an intelligent driver, decided to quickly take initiative. The Bible says he put forth his hand because the oxen shook it. What happened? And the anger of the Lord was kindled against Uzzah. And who smote him? Please read with me. And God smote him there for his what? It didn't say for his sin. It was not a sin. It was an error. He smote him for his error. And there he died by the ark of God. So men can die by the ark. I thought the ark was supposed to give life. Yet a man is dying by the ark, and the ark did not bring him back to life. Next verse. And David was displeased because the Lord had made a breach upon Uzzah. And he called the name of the place Perez Uzzah to this day. And David was afraid of the Lord that day and said, how shall the ark of the Lord come to me? He was afraid. So David could not remove the ark of the Lord to the city of David. But David carried the same ark inside the house of a man called Obed-Edom, the Gittite. Are we together now? Remember that the ark just killed somebody now. Will you allow them to bring it to your house? I mean, something that killed somebody there. They say, please help us and keep this for 90 days. He said, no, please. Take it to the pastor that brought it out. And the ark of the Lord continued in the house of Obed-Edom the Gittite 3 months. And what happened? The Lord blessed Obed-Edom and all his house. And it was told King David, saying, they expected a bad news. Ah! Obed-Edom. So just like Uzzah, you too, you have died. And the news came. They said, King, you need to hear something. The Lord had blessed the house of Obed-Edom and all that pertained unto him because of the ark of the Lord. And so David said, ah, that means that ark is still what we know it to be. Let's go back and get it. Is it not amazing that the same ark can kill one and the same ark can lift another? Now, my teaching tonight is not to tell you why. Are we together? I'm just showing you that there were patterns, and not even the sincerity of a man corrupting the pattern spared him. 4. 1 Kings 18. The whole context is from 17 to 40. But then we'll start from verse 24 for the sake of time. It's a long reading. Please pay attention. I'm showing you these things, and then we'll tie up something and pray tonight. Now, this is Elijah the Tishbite challenging the prophets of Baal to a context at Mount Carmel. Are we together? Until that time, Elijah had shut the heavens. And Elijah wanted to present himself before Ahab. And Obadiah was afraid. He said, if I go and tell Ahab you are here, what if the spirit of the Lord carries you as usual and they don't find you? They are going to kill me. Are we together? And Elijah said, no problem. You go and tell Ahab. He now meets Ahab and says, okay, gather your prophets, 450 of them, he says. And then when you gather them up the mountain, you will come there and I will meet with you and we'll resolve this issue of loyalty to God once and for all. Are you getting the context now? So, verse 24, and call ye on the name of your gods, and I will call on the name of the Lord, and the God that answered by fire, let him be God. And all the people answered, it is well spoken. Context is about to begin. 25. And Elijah said unto the prophets of Baal, choose you one bullock for yourself, and dress it, for ye are many, and call upon the name of your gods. Put no fire under it. And they took the bullock which was given them, and they dressed it and called upon the name of Baal from morning even until noon, saying, O Baal, hear us. But there was no voice nor any answer, and they leaped upon the altar which was made. Look at all the skills they were employing to bring Baal to show up. And it came to pass at noon, Elijah mocked them. If you were Elijah, will you be praying or mocking them? Your turn is soon to come. You are seeing confirmed prophets. If those prophets were not effective, they would not be in the palace of the king. And here they are calling. If I were Elijah, I'll be saying, oh Lord, you too, you are seeing that these gods are not, you please, you show up here. I've finished making noise with you. But Elijah was so confident of the patterns, he could afford to mock them. He said, cry aloud, for he is a god. Either he is talking, or he is pursuing, or he is in a journey. Peradventure he sleepeth and must be awaked. And they cried aloud. Through the people heard him and still cried. And cut themselves after their manner with knives and lancets, until blood gushed out from among them. Now, start reading carefully. And it came to pass when the midday was past, and they prophesied until when? Read with me. Until when? It didn't say until evening. Until the time of the offering of the evening sacrifice. Elijah knew when to sacrifice. Elijah, he said, you continue to call. He used them to delay time until the evening sacrifice. And then, listen, he says there was no voice or any to answer that regarded. 30. And Elijah said unto the people, he said, now is evening, come near. Come near unto me. And the people came near to him, and he repaired the altar of the Lord that was broken down. You think he would just say, God, come down? Next verse. And Elijah took 12 stones. This, remember, the whole thing is to get fire to come down. And I thought there was a time he was resting on a mountain, and people came and he commanded fire. Couldn't he now do it again to come? Just by speaking. And Elijah said, it doesn't work that way. There are patterns. The 12 stones according to the tribes of unto whom the word of the Lord came, saying, Israel shall be my name. Now let's leave this, because this is a very deep expression. Next verse. And with the stones he built an altar in the name of the Lord, and he made trench about the altar as great as would contain 2 measures of seed. And he put the wood in order, and he cut the bullock in pieces, and laid the wood, and said, fill 4 barrels with water, and pour it upon the burnt sacrifices. Listen, he was not pouring water just to prove that he didn't hide fire somewhere. That water was a mystery. Do it the second time, and they did it. Do it the third time, and he did it. 35. And water ran about the altar, and he filled the trench also with water. Do you not read of this in Ezekiel 47? That water can come out from a certain place at the temple and flow, and that kind of water heals. It doesn't kill. Here he's reproducing that kind of result, and the Bible says the water is flowing. Do you not know that from the throne room there is a river that comes out? There's something this guy is creating. He's not just mounting this. He's not a herbalist. Next verse. And it came to pass at the time of the offering of the evening sacrifice that Elijah the prophet came near. Hear what he said. O Lord God of Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, until this time we did not know the God of Elijah. Elijah is writing his own history, and it is Elisha that will now teach us that Elijah had successfully captured a dimension called the God of Elijah. So he had to use the patterns that he knew. Please leave it for us. The God of Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, let it be known this day that thou art God in Israel, that I am thy servant and have done these things according to your word. 39. Hear me, O Lord, that these people will know that thou art God, and that thou hast turned their heart back again. And then the fire of the Lord fell and consumed the burnt sacrifice and the wood and stones and dust and licked up the water that was in the trench. 39. And when the people saw it, they fell on their faces and they said, the Lord, he is God. The Lord, he is God. You provide the fire. I'll provide the sacrifice. If you provide the spirit, I will open up inside. Fill me up. Violated that pattern, the salvation of that land was at stake of a man's complying to divine patterns. It's not because he was Elijah. God kept watching as the patterns were complied. Listen, my brothers and my sisters, we're going to pray shortly. I want you to sit down. Exodus chapter 25. This is the building of the tabernacle in the wilderness. I want to tie this up now. Exodus chapter 25. We're going to read verse 9, then we will jump to verse 40. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Exodus chapter 25 and verse 9. This is Moses receiving instructions from God. Please come, Victor. Moses is receiving instructions from God. Hallelujah. Sorry about that. 29, verse 9. Look up, please, everybody. According to all that I showed thee. After what? The pattern. What pattern? There was a tabernacle in heaven. Remember that Jesus, as the high priest, in the similitude of Melchizedek, carried his blood to that tabernacle and offered it once and for all. That's how the atonement was perfected. Is that true? Are we Bible students? It was Paul that was teaching us this in his Pauline epistles. And so we see that Moses was granted access to see that pattern, and he was asked to reproduce it. And he said, according to all that I showed thee, after the pattern of the tabernacle and the pattern of all the instruments, even so shall ye make it. Verse 40. And he said again, this is God reminding them while they are building, and look that thou make them after what? Their pattern, which was shown thee on the mount. That I showed you a pattern, and I want you to, do you know it was an account, on account of God's desire for pattern, that the spirit of creativity came upon a man called Bezaleel. It came to ensure that the dimensions were captured accurately. Very powerful the way these things work. The pattern of God captured in a way and a manner that you would be surprised, my brothers and my sisters, that all this happens and God refused to show up. The glory was never seen. God kept saying, make sure. Remember, the goal was that he would come and find a resting place there. But he says, I define the dimensions. And he kept supervising. He kept supervising. He would come and look and say, make sure that you build this so according to pattern. Make sure you build this according to pattern. Let me show you one verse. I found this verse and it blessed me. Ezekiel chapter 43. Let's look at verse 7. Ezekiel 43 and verse 7. And then we'll tie this all up and then we'll pray. Ezekiel 47. Do we have it? Thank you. Verse 7. And he said unto me, son of man, listen. The place of my throne and the place of the soles of my feet, where I will dwell in the midst of the children of Israel forever, and my holy name shall become the house of Israel, shall the house of Israel no more defile, and they nor their kings by their whoredom, nor the carcasses of the kings in their high places. 8. And their setting of their threshold by my threshold. Listen, they have their own, I have my own. And their post by my post. That means when they start shifting their dimensions to be the same as my own, that their threshold becomes like my threshold. Their posts by my post. And the walls between me and them, they have even defied the holy name by their abominations that they have committed. Wherefore I have consumed them in my anger. Verse 9. Now let them put away their whoredom and the carcasses of their kings far from me, and I will dwell in the midst of them forever. 10. Thou son of man, show the house to the house of Israel, that they may be ashamed of their iniquities, and let them measure the pattern. I show you why my presence is not here. It's because the dimensions that I gave were not kept. And so it looks like I do not want to show up. And he calls it whoredom, harlotry. You received another blueprint from another person. And he says, restore the patterns. Let it be in sync with that which is my own pattern. Are you getting what I'm saying now? Very powerful. When I found that scripture, it blessed me in no small way. The Bible tells us, listen carefully. In Jeremiah chapter 6, you know it, very popular scripture. And verse 6, I believe, 6 verse 6. It says, is it 6, 6 or 16, 16 or so, thereabout. As for the ancient part, help me someone. Yes. Well, please find it for us. I know it should be. Okay, help us media. That you ask for the ancient part, he says, and that you walk therein. And that by walking therein, you find rest. There is a relationship between walking in the ancient paths and finding rest for your soul. Ask for the ancient path. Listen, the ancient path is not a denomination's path. The ancient path is not a religious path. The ancient path is a pattern that was allocated to capture a dimension of God. Every dimension of God that we seek to see manifest in our lives, our businesses, our churches, our ministries, that dimension is hidden in a pattern. It's a spiritual pattern. It's not a religious pattern. Now, in the Old Testament, it had to do with physical dimensions. But in the New Testament, it's not about building physical dimensions, but it's about a dimension of understanding of the ways of God and aligning to those ways. The Bible calls those patterns in the New Testament the keys of the kingdom. The keys of the kingdom. These are the keys by which the heavens are open and the heavens are shut. These are the keys by which realities happen in this kingdom or otherwise. Matthew chapter 16 and verse 19, Jesus is teaching here, and he says that I give you the keys of the kingdom, he says, and that whatever is bound on earth is also bound in heaven, and whatever is loosed on earth is also loosed in heaven. In chapter 13 and verse 11, same Matthew, he says, for it has been given unto you to know the mysteries of the kingdom. This kingdom is a compendium of mysteries. It's not enough to just be born again, to give your life to Christ. Spiritual growth is measured in this kingdom by two indices. Number one, your degree of conformity to the image and the character of Christ in experience. And then number two, your comprehension of the patterns and the ways of the kingdom. These are the two indices that measure your spiritual growth. If these two things are not happening to you, you are not growing. There must be a comprehension of the ways of the kingdom. Are we together now? Yes. You are called a spiritually mature person, not by your longevity in the Christian faith necessarily, but your ability to capture the patterns of God. Like a doctor, you can look at people and diagnose what spiritual pattern is needed to be introduced in their lives. Someone can come to you and say, man of God, I love God so much, but there's all kinds of oppression in our family. And you know from that there is a need for the deliverer to come. And you say, I know the mysteries. I know the spiritual tokens that must be put together to capture that dimension of God. And the person returns back and says, I did as you said. And in the name of the Lord, it was a sign and a wonder. Lord, why is it that I love you? We all love you, but Lord, we are born again in this family, but all doors are closed. It's interrupting our love for you. We love you, but nothing is working. 10 people, no job. We love you, Lord. Solve this thing so we can have the time to serve you. And your prayer request is calling for a name of God. And that name of God will be answered to you by a revelation of a pattern. And God says, there is something your family does not know about me and my ways that is causing, although you are well-meaning, anointed and blessed people, the dimension you have captured is the dimension you see. That's why you can be praying in the house and the power of God will break out and you will be blessed, because by the sacrifice of alignment, you have hosted that is dimension. But doors will never open no matter what happens, because there is the key of David. And whoever holds it can open a door that no man. You are opening doors that men are shutting. You are using other keys. The key of David opens a door that no man can shut. So you can go to a land that should not receive you, but because you went with a key, you go there, and it's amazing that those who hate you are the ones who are forced to announce you. They are not even aware they are doing that, and you are watching with shock and wonder, and people say, how are you doing it? You subscribe to a pattern. The integrity of God is so powerful. If that pattern is obeyed, it will force men to make sure that they prove his worthiness in that area. When God was ready to come to the earth, he had to come through the pattern of becoming flesh. Not even the word could be manifest without becoming flesh. So there was a search for a virgin. And then when he found that woman, because God will not violate the will of men, The angel had to come and ask for permission. Madam, we want to use your womb to bring the Savior. She said, how shall these things be? The same question Zechariah asked. They punished him and answered Mary. Zechariah was an innocent man offering sacrifices. Gabriel appears before him. And then he questions Gabriel. And he says, no, but you are a priest. You should be more mature than that. I am Gabriel. I just came from the presence of God. Can lie exist in his presence? Do you not respect the presence of God? I just came from his presence to you. And his mouth was shut. Do you know why? Because he was a priest. And by the grace upon him, he could interrupt what God was doing. So they had to shut his mouth, not his hands. They shut his mouth till he called the child John. No prayer. The mouth opened. What is the name of this child? He would have said something and destroyed the destiny of John. Destroyed the destiny of Jesus. The mouth remained shut till he wrote John. Then the mouth opened. This earth you see is submerged in mysteries and patterns. There are men who have found them. There are men of God who have found them. There are business people who have found them. There are young people who have found them. Their results show they have found them. The Bible says that when you seek, you will find. Remember? Yes, sir. Was it not Psalm 91, the Psalm of David? David opened us up to the things that happen on earth. Please give it to us and let me show you something. My goodness. Halibra haskuzia hasaj. Kabrondes kedebekarash. Give us the Psalm of David, please. Psalm 91. Blessed be the name of the Lord. It says, he that dwelleth in the secret place. Where is it? Where is the secret place? Can you tell me the address of that place called the secret place? Because the Bible says a man can go there. So where is it? Whoever gets there, he says, he shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. Verse 2 says, and I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge and fortress, my God, in him will I trust. Verse 3. Now listen to mysteries now. The psalmist. Remember, the psalmist was a man of the secret place. He was a man after God's heart. And he's teaching us the mysteries that happen in our world that we do not know. Are you ready now? He says, surely he shall deliver you from the snare of the fowler and from the noisome pestilence. Verse 4. He shall cover thee with his feathers, and under his wings shalt thou trust. His truth and I shall be thy shield and buckler. 5. Thou shalt not be afraid of the terror. By what? That means there is a kind of evil that only happens in the night. The programming of that evil is such that it never happens in the day. It is only in the night. It says, nor the arrow that flyeth by day. Notice he's putting time to those events. That this kind of arrow does not fly by day, by night. No. You will search it in the night. If something happened to you in the night, it was something else. But this one flies by day. Nor the pestilence that walketh in darkness. Nor the destruction that wasted the moment it is 12 noon. This is not some superstitious thing, my brothers and my sisters. This is a man who knows God. And he's showing you that submerged in this our world, we are interacting with mysteries day and night. And that it is those who through knowledge have created a fortification, taking advantage of the resources of the Spirit to immune themselves, that these are the ones that will reign. Are you getting what I'm teaching you now? And so he says that, verse 7 please, it says, 1,000 shall fall by your side, 10,000 by your right side, but none shall come nigh thee. Verse 8 says, only with your eyes shall you behold and see the reward of the wicked. Was it not Jesus that was giving a parable that when human beings sleep on earth, strangers come into our earth and plant things and go back? Come on, Bible students. Don't act as if I'm the only one that has a Bible. Have you not read it? That Jesus can look at something and say, no, a stranger, an enemy, has done this. A man and his wife go to bed in the night. They sleep sound and happy. But while they are sleeping, that there are activities that happen in the earth. The next thing, they wake up, and that's the beginning of divorce. It was not about the man hating the woman. Something happened. That a man can promise you that he will give you a job and truly swear by himself that he will give you a job, and all of a sudden you go to bed in the night and the man wakes up in the morning with intense hatred for you. Remember, you're a man of God, and you go back to his office and he looks at you and says, I told you I will help you. He said, yes. He said, sorry, I'm sure I was busy. He said, but sir, I thought you said my father, please, out of my office. Nothing just happens. Members don't just come to a church. No, sir. It's not true. Remember, Paul plants, Apollo waters, but increase in the is only, it is God himself that supervises increase. That means if increase is not coming, there is an explanation. It's an uncomfortable truth, but it's true. There is a name God is called. He's called the Lord of the harvest. The Lord, the owner of every harvest. So when you see a true harvest, he released it. Are we together now? I show you patterns here. Was it not in your Bible that the hand of God came upon Elijah? We're going to pray shortly. And the Bible says Elijah ran on barefoot. Had you ever read that a man ran on barefoot and overtook the chariot of a king? That means it is possible that something can be manipulated around your life, that before the end of November, what could not come in 5 years now comes. Now listen, you have to believe this. You call it a miracle. In the realm of the spirit, is called patterns aligned together. Yes, sir. Look at this. Samuel is on his way just doing all his work. Saul, the son of Kish, loses a donkey. Remember, their father's donkey disappears. And then they go looking for it. And after 3 days, they don't find that donkey. And they said, let's go back so our father will not leave the issue of donkey and be worried. He said, there is a man I know. He's a man of God. If we meet that man, he can do something about this donkey. Now listen carefully. As soon as the eye of Saul sees Samuel, the donkey starts going back home. No prayer was prayed. Saul just looks at Samuel and the donkey is on his way back home. Sir, we came and said, you didn't come for donkey. Don't worry, the donkey is on his way back home. Climb up. Let me tell you what is in your heart. Is it not because the Lord has anointed you to be king? He anointed him. And he said, 3 things will happen to you. Number one, your donkey is back home. Number two, he said, you're on your way going back home. You will see 3 men holding 2 loaves of bread. These guys bought bread. They were taking it to go and give their families. But because of something that suddenly came on you, they will salute you and give you. Every helper has relatives in need. Don't forget that. Nobody just helps you. No. Every helper has his relatives who are also praying for a helper. What will make him leave them and come to you? It's not normal. Honor, this thing we fight for, honor is not an achievement. It's a mantle. Read about Aaron and his sons. Read about Moses. He was instructed to take some of his honor and put upon Aaron. If it's not on you, it's not on you. It's as simple as that. How about the power of the Holy Spirit? Now, I know that this is a PFN crusade, but please permit my bias. When I sat here and I just looked around this church, I just nodded my head. I said, this system called Bishop Oyedepo. That's all I said. I just nodded my head. I said, this man of God, that God can send a word to Jacob, and then that word lights upon Israel, and the results show. When he was meeting with God, he was not in Kano. Yet Kano had to receive the impact of that encounter. The same way right now, you are not in London where you will soon go. Listen. But you are in Kano, yet you will receive something that will swing open the two lift gates and you will step in. Just like you are sitting down right now, you've never seen even a spoon in the realm of the spirit, but all of a sudden it looks as if you are sitting in another world and you are watching as vista upon vista of spiritual reality open. And you say, so this is the mystery behind prophecy. I thought it was a lie. Honestly, I thought people just conjoined. So this is true. The God of patterns. The God that leads men by showing them what ordinary eyes cannot see. Come, Pastor. When God wants to lift you, this is what he does. It's like an initiation. He will call you and say, my son, come. He will take you to the inner chambers of the spirit and say, sit down. It's like a control room that manipulates earth and tells you, this is what is responsible for this outcome. This is what is responsible for this outcome. This is what is responsible for this outcome. And then when that body of knowledge is given to you, then a grace is supplied you. And he says, go. Listen, everybody will see you go, but they watch the gates open, open, open. And they say, what is it about this man? Anything you see about any man that is not normal was gotten in the spirit. There is nothing supernatural that is gotten naturally. Listen, you don't bless people with what money can buy. I know people say, I bless you. It's a lie. True blessings are not physical. If anybody ever blesses you and you collected something tangible, it's true, it's a blessing. You say, he blessed me. But true blessings are an invocation of something on you that begins to manipulate realities around you in a way that makes your life to become a name that God uses. Are you getting blessed? Are you learning something this night? My brothers and my sisters, I came trusting the Lord to make your spiritual journey easy. And that the ease, I have seen many, now I know you've heard me say it, our generation is not lacking revelation. Go online, switch on your TV, you will see dimensions of God. I mean, there are all kinds of people who have been given the eyes and the ears of the Spirit. Just go online and Google any topic. You will find men of God with different dimensions. Sometimes you hold your Bible and wonder if this is the same Bible you are holding. But the problem is the experience of the kingdom. There are too many things we propose in the spirit, but we do not have the patterns to reproduce them. And it is when your light shines before men, God wants them to see. For as long as we keep making propositions, we don't have the grace component to defend. A day will come, we will look like puppets to our world. They will be used to hearing us rap and give the jamboree. He's the Lion of the tribe of Judah. He's the Rose of Sharon. He can change your life. He's the God of this. And the woman who is sitting down with 10 years miscarriage, and the young lady who is sitting down wondering why doors cannot open, and the young man who wants to go into ministry, who carries a fire in his spirit and knows that God can do this, is wondering. He goes back to the secret place to pray, and God tells him, I'm more than what you have seen. And he comes out, and there is no example enough. There are many people Their lives look like they are rebels. They are not rebels. They are just looking for a standard high enough for them to follow. That the standards that are around them relative to what God is showing them is too low. It's not that they don't want to listen, but something in them says no, no, no. How can 100 deaf people be there and only 2 their ears? Is that a testimony? Something tells them no, there is so much. If you are not careful, you would think they are proud. They are not proud. It's the hunger for the revival that is coming that God is saying no, there has to be more. And some of them are the people seated looking at me. There are some of you, you love God. You even came from Christian families. But sometimes after service, you still sit back and say, was this all for the 3 hours? You don't mean to be sarcastic. Honestly, you buy the tape and sit down. You want to play it and you are almost stopping. And saying, Lord, how do I explain to people I'm not arrogant? How do I explain to people it's not pride? And you go back to bed and you see a crusade where there were 100 wheelchairs and 100 people stood up. And you say, this is it. This is it. I saw it. This meeting is not for people who are passive about God, who just want to get one message here and there and just know one mystery somewhere and just teach in one group somewhere and lay hands on someone to just fall somewhere and just receive a little accolades from a group of spiritual mediocres somewhere and just say, I did A and B. No. This is a meeting for people who are saying, Lord, there has to be a way of bringing these nations to the authority and the power of the Christ. There has to be a way of making our lives become living epistles. There has to be a way, oh God, there. I may not know and I confess my ignorance. I'm not ashamed, but God, I call unto you. Will you not answer and show me things I do not know? I'm like a spiritual archaeologist. I know that many of you listen to my teachings and you've heard about the miracles and the things that God does and is doing. And I thank God for that. But can I tell you, compared to where God is taking me, I tell the people close to me, I've not even started. When people clap and say, Apostle is this and that, I say, my goodness. If this is what I celebrate as achievement, shame on me and shame on my knowledge of God. There are still heights and dimensions. There are still graces and territories. That a day will come, we will subdue nations in one day. Not as a rhetoric. So while we thank God for the little here and there that by His Spirit He is doing, there remains a hunger. We know. You finish a meeting and you watch the wheelchairs go back. And while your revelation was powerful, your confirmation was F. If God is the God you claim, where was His power? And you see the person wheeling back and even says, man of God, I have a little seed for you. And on that wheelchair, he collects and he called you man that comes from God. But the Bible says in John chapter 1 verse 6 that there was a man sent from God. He says his name was John. He said he came as a witness, not as a preacher. That is for tomorrow. That through him all men might believe. My brothers and my sisters, I came to wake you up this night. Thank God for the little we've seen. Thank God for the little prophecies here and there. Thank you for the little word of knowledge. Thank God for your group, your church, your ministry. Thank God for the prayer, fire and this. But let me tell you, we are only one step out of the cave compared to God's true intention. Thank you for your ministry of psalmistry. Thank you for the apostolic grace and fire. But if we do not humble ourselves and say, Lord, more is the language. In a time like this, we must allow that eternity swallow up everything we have done. To say, Lord, thank you for what I've seen. But there needs to be more. Do you know sometimes when I read my Bible, I just close it and begin to cry. You've heard my encounters. And I submit to you, maybe tomorrow I'll share with you a few of them. The man talking to you with all humility, is not somebody who is ignorant of the power and the grace of God. I have had experiences that I don't share because the controversy they will create will be too much. And sometimes I just keep quiet. I may not claim to know everything about God, but I've seen a bit of Him. And I know. Are we together now? Yes. I've had times where I'm reading my Bible in the realm of the Spirit, and my eyes open and my Bible has opened physically to that exact same place, and I continue reading it because God is saying this and that. I've searched for things in the internet, I did not find them, and I fell asleep by the Spirit and found myself searching, and then the name of the person and the information, and I woke up and did not need to check it again. What more will you look for? That's what is destroying many of us. The enemy of tomorrow is your result of today. You must trust God for grace, who for the joy that was set before Him. My brothers, don't forget that this grace is seeking expression transgenerationally. So the little that God is doing in our churches and groups, and my dear friends in the Lord, I bring you a word that there is more. Let's thank God for what He has given us. But that pride and complacency that will keep us to think I have arrived. The only men who arrive in this kingdom are men who have died. Hunger is a sign of life. When people are sick, one of the traces is they lose appetite. The moment someone loses appetite, you know he's sick. So when there is no appetite for you spiritually, it's not a sign that you are a great man. It's a sign you are losing something. Is God speaking to us tonight? Yes. What do you not know about God? Imagine what will happen to your family when you understand the patterns of God. There are some of you after this conference, if you will run home and say, Mama, I found it. She will say, found what? You mean you got employment? Say, if it was employment, I will not shout like this. I found the key. I found the key to your 12 years prayer. I found the key. I found what can dislodge the power of darkness. I found what can save all the loved ones. And your mother will say, well, is it not that your prayer group? Well done. May God keep helping you as young people. Until you just make one utterance, and in 3 days, your brother who has been missing for years returns back on his knees. And your mother says, come, what did you say you found yesterday? What did you say you found? When we find things, the evidence shows. If there is no proof, you have not found it. No matter how you convince yourself. We are going to pray. And I want you to cry your heart. I'm stopping here because I want us to take a few minutes to pray. I look across this place and I see men and women of God. Did you know, I thank you for the honor that you have for me and the dear men of God around this city and around. But do you know that God's design is for you too to become a reference, a pattern, that someone can look and say, out of Kano, there was a young lady. We have seen the prophetic, but not in this dimension. There was a young man. He always goes for meetings and sits quietly. But little did we know that God was raising a standard through that person. Are we together now? We are going to pray. Spiritual patterns. Years ago, when the Lord was showing me these things, I sat down and I said, my God, who will believe some of these things? And the Lord said, it is true. Remember, scripture says you can do nothing against the truth, but for the truth. I just returned from Ogun State, and I had the opportunity to stay at the MFM prayer ground. I've been to almost all the major camps and headquarters and prayer grounds around this nation, belonging to the major denominations. I've been there, I've visited those places. And every time I visit those places, usually I take out time to walk around. And I say, Lord, This thing is not the issue of intelligence. There is a spiritual pattern. There was a grace for territory that was upon an age range of men of God. All of them, from the least to the greatest, caught something about that dimension. And I said, Lord, there's something we are missing. There is something we're missing. I remember praying there and crying before God and say, Lord, which of these graces is not in my life? I would have said, I'm a man of God. Which fellow man of God like me is there? No. When you are ready to receive spiritual patterns, you don't receive as a man of God. You receive as a hungry and a desperate person. Let me give you one example and then we'll pray. It's a popular story. Those of you who have followed my teachings, I will shorten it very quickly. I went to Ekiti and I found out that there was an unusual grace. I'll teach you some things about the anointing tomorrow. I found out that the obituaries of the people I saw, nobody was less than 100 years. Just after Landmark University, a small community there, a strange grace for long life. Every time you see a widespread dimension, something happened within that territory. Whether through the covenant of sacrifice that made God swear his integrity upon that place. And I said, there has to be a reason why these people live strangely and mysteriously long. We passed a place and I saw a man who had just gone to be with the Lord. 132 years. Yet, the international newspaper are saying that the oldest people are 114. They should come to Nigeria, the place of mysteries. And then I finished ministering in Ekiti. And then I was on my way back to the airport in Kwara State now. While we're on our way back, I said, we have to stop at that house and at least see the people. Then I saw another obituary, 140, I think 41 or 45. In Nigeria. Yet somebody is in a family that doesn't live more than 40. Whereas the grace for long life is still within your territory. Everybody say spiritual patterns. And then we stopped there and it was a small place and, you know, it's like nobody around could speak English. It looked like a Christian place. They looked like people who loved God. There were pockets of churches around. And then we found someone who could interpret for us. And I said, I'm a man of God passing, but we have discerned that there is grace for long life here. And we want them to take us to the oldest man of God around to pray for us for that grace. Listen carefully. And then eventually they looked for someone that was supposedly the oldest man there. He looked somebody who would just be an elder. Yet only God knows how old that man was. And then when we came and they interpreted, they said, sir, we are here because we believe that there is a deposit of the grace for long life. I thought the man would say, no, it's just that it happens. The man smiled and said, kneel down. Those who know these things know they know it. And they know they carry it. A hospital does not look for patients. A hospital just stays somewhere and every patient, even if you are in ICU, you are carried there. And when we stayed there, we knelt down and the man started praying in Yoruba and speaking, and I just felt like a crown. Remember, I'm a man of God. I felt like a crown coming upon my head. And immediately he finished, we got up, we thanked him, sowed into his life, truly honored him. I was on my way to enter the car, and then I saw the women who we had contacted at first. And then I went to tell them thank you. And when I got there, they looked like maybe women in their 60s, you know, or early 70s. I went to thank them, and they tapped me and said, this woman standing is the wife of the 132-year-old man. Ah, no stick, dentition complete. That woman would be like 120s or something like that. yet she was standing. You would think she's just 60 years. I said, let's go back. No way. Not going back. I mean, if that man has died and two have become one, I don't know whether to call her a grandmother, a great-grandmother, an ancestor. What do you call a 120? And then the woman tapped me and said, come. And we came. She opened a room and started showing me pictures. She was the wife of his youth. Not Keturah when Sarah died. And they just brought the one and only woman that man married. And then she showed the picture up until the final moment of the death. And the man, I think he just died a natural death. And I looked at her. And I told the interpreter, please tell her, Baba has prayed for us, but please, the grace, that 132 dimension, even if it's just your own, we are still grateful. Just pray. And the woman smiled and she said, kneel down. And the woman took off her shoes and placed her feet on bare ground and said, I should kneel down. And for about 15 minutes, this woman was praying and prophesying on my head. I honestly didn't care what she was saying. All I knew was that from that day, whether the plane shakes and turns, I will sleep sound. For many reasons, listen, because number one, I have found from the word. Number two, I have chosen life. Number three, I have honored his system that is within that territory for life. When I received that grace, I thanked her. I got up and I ran straight to my people. That service, before I preached, I said, all of you stand up. You can't believe what I brought for you. Before I preach, let's impart this grace quickly. And I prayed for my people with all my heart. And I prayed because I know the kind of family I'm coming from. My father doesn't have brothers. They all died. I watched them die like chickens. And remember, I'm connected by blood. So it is true that I love the Lord. But it's not enough to just say I shall not die. You must align to his systems. Was he not a man that spoke and extended the life of Hezekiah? Hezekiah was built to die, but God told the prophet, go and add his life. And he added 15 years. The same way men can shorten the lives of others. This is the place of encounter. The place of surrender. This is the place where my life is changed. Do to me what you want. Exodus chapter 40 and verse 33. We're praying. And he reared up the court round about. Remember where we started from. This is Moses instructed to keep patterns. And the Bible says, and the altar and set up the hanging of the court gate. Read the last sentence, everybody. One, two, go. So Moses finished the work. Everything God said to do according to patterns, he did it. And finished. 34. That's someone's testimony. Then a cloud. God kept watching until the patterns were complied with to verbatim. And then a cloud covered the tent of the congregation. And the glory of the Lord filled the tabernacle. Next verse. And Moses was not able to enter into the tent of the congregation because the cloud abode thereon, and the glory of the Lord filled the tabernacle. Listen, the glory of God, among other things, is a confirmation that his patterns have been kept. The glory of God made manifest is proof that his pattern has been kept. My brothers and my sisters, when you want to see the glory of the Lord manifest in your life, then you must walk in keeping with his patterns. God kept watching them until they complied with his patterns. Then the Shekinah of God. I could imagine God saying, now I've found a resting place. And he comes to that wilderness and rests upon that place. And the cloud was so dense to the point that Moses could not even enter and minister. Could this be the secret to seeing the glory of God in our churches? Could it be that it may not necessarily be new sermons? Could it be that it may not necessarily be more revelation? It could be more alignment. So that when we stand in that pattern, then the glory of God, then we will see burdens lifted. Then we will see lives change. Then you can stand and tell people, the Lord bless you. And by next Sunday, there will not be time for testimonies. Because someone will say, please, can you give me 30 minutes to tell you what God did? And you say, is it not every day that I'm saying God bless you? You said this one according to pattern. When you align to patterns, let me tell you, my brothers and my sisters, you force the integrity of God to come. There are financial patterns. There are patterns that govern the operation of the anointing. There are patterns that govern the operation of the gifts of the Spirit. Did the Bible not say the more excellent way of walking in the gifts of the Spirit is to walk by love? That means I can walk in the gifts of the Spirit, but I can walk by love in the gifts of the Spirit. And God says I will be more effective because I'm walking in the gift of the Spirit in a more excellent way. There are patterns that are responsible for speed. Man of God, there are patterns that can open you up to the realms of visions and the prophetic. There are spiritual patterns. And tonight, we are going to pray. And our prayer is a cry to heaven. And we are going to say, Lord, show me your ways. Open my eyes to the patterns of the Spirit that will cause me to be effective to a generation. In a time like this, oh God, I cry for patterns. Lift your voice and pray. Let's pray.
Before your royal majesty,
keep praying.
I cast my crown before the highest royalty. I am undone before your royal majesty. You're the King of kings and Lord, your royal majesty, you're the King of kings and Lord of lords, royal. Aljanna. Hey, abunida kau, sujana nida kau, serking salama, serking aljanna. Alabaka prakaso de baladabo, endekete la hasaga baka pradege de baladabo.
Number two, Lord, the mystery I must know to rise to the new dimension. Open my eyes. Give me the gift of comprehension. Open your mouth and pray. Man of God, pray. There is something my eyes needs to see. Lord, what is the pattern for the prayer that heaven must answer? What is the key? Open my eyes, oh God. You reign,
want to pray for you. I'm seeing a grace and his hunger for the things of the Spirit. I want to pray for you. Tonight is a night of encounter. I just wanted to bring the people out, make sure they don't injure themselves. I stretch my hands and I pray that this mantle of the secret praise, the grace that I stretch my hands by the rod of a higher priesthood, let that grace find you now. Bring them out. Kaporeketa, I speak and I shift you in the spirit. Enter a dimension of the grace for intimacy, encounter by the power of the living God. Kalabakata, salakata, grace, multiplied vision. Your Majesty, Your Majesty, Your Majesty, that grace is coming on you. Your Majesty,
Your Majesty,
Your Majesty. Hallelujah. I'm hearing in my spirit the grace of Deborah. Where are they? The grace of Deborah. I stretch my hands now from the front to the back. Where are the daughters of Zion? I call you by prophecy. The season has come. The grace of Deborah. Vision. Grace. Kabarakata kalakata. Bring them out. The grace of Deborah. I stretch my hand. Drink of that wine. Women of prayer. The wailing women upon the watchful. The world. I release upon you the grace. Sing the songs of Miriam. Kalados Kabarata. It was Miriam that sang and said, I will sing unto the Lord, for he has triumphed gloriously. Even the horses and his rider have been cast into the sea. Hallelujah. We're going to round up. Tomorrow I'll have time to minister and pray for people. But I'm seeing the number 39. And the Lord is telling me that those 39 people, there is a grace for the prophetic. Lord, where are they? I'm seeing the number 39. Some of you are already in ministry. Some of you are in different groups. Right now I stretch my hand. Help them please. Whether you are an usher or not, please help them. Right now I declare that grace, the eyes of the eagle, the eyes that see and the ears that hear, I call the living water of the prophetic within your spirit. Let there be a stirring. Let there be a stirring of that grace. Hallelujah. We have to round up. But I'm seeing the Lord is showing me someone who is Victoria. Victoria. I'm hearing the name Victoria. Hold on, please. What, tomorrow we'll have time to minister. I just want Victoria. Where is Victoria? This Victoria is wearing like pink You are wearing like wrapper from the head, pink and something. This is the Victoria that I'm seeing. Is there someone like that? What's your name? Please help me confirm.
Victoria.
Your name is Victoria. No, I'm going to pray for you. But the Lord is saying, I should tell you that the season of laughter for your family has come. Take it higher for me, Mike. Tomorrow we'll have time to pray. My dear, the Lord is rolling away the reproach. I don't know, you have never seen you. But the Lord is saying to tell you that He's rolling away the reproach from your life. He's rolling away the reproach from your life.
Hi there, God bless you and welcome to a brand new year, 2024. The scripture speaking, He said, I will do a new thing. Shall you not know it? What are the proof that God is doing a new thing in this season of your life is that you will definitely be aware of that which God is doing. And by His mercies, through the speakings, the prophetic word for this year, by the mouth of His servant, Apostle Joshua Selman, on this platform, Reflector Hub TV, we encourage you to stay tuned, engage your faith, and believe God for every prophetic word that you have received in this new year for your life, for your family, for your ministry, and for all that concerns you, be it your health, be it your finance, and your career. Everything is set to be refreshed and made brand new by the word of the Lord. If you are a new viewer on this channel, we'd like you to hit the subscribe button so as to also be engaged with what God is doing for this season. And if you are not getting notifications, you can hit the subscribe button, or rather you can hit the notification bell so as to stay in touch with our daily uploads. And don't forget to share this video to your family and friends, loved ones, so that they too can be aligned with what God is doing for this season. We love you so much. Welcome to 2024. Happy New Year.